1,200 miles off the coast of New England, is one of the richest fishing grounds on Earth. The Grand Banks,
yeah, baby.
Home to brutal weather and unpredictable seas. This is where the perfect storm exploded. Over the years, thousands of lives have been lost here. Yet every fall, a few brave fishermen risk everything as they sail these deadly waters in search of giants. It's deep into the fall storm season. The crews have reached their breaking points.
Oh, Archie, I just got electrocuted.
Stay away. Look at me, Dave.
God, it sucks. I'm ready to get out of here.
And the captains are in a race to top off their holds before the fishing season ends.
I'm hoping there's still a few nice ones left.
I think I've come up here and showed them that I can hold my own.
Now, life is on the line as the search for swords continues. Miles off the New England coast, Captain Scotty and the crew of the Eagle Eye 2 are on the longest voyage of their careers.
You know, you're not used to putting in this many, you know, 20-hour days in a row. Like I say, there's gonna be a big smile on my face when the guys say no more bait.
So far, Chris and the crew have been fishing non-stop for 27 days. But Scotty can't afford to lose the 3 days it would take to offload. That's 3 days of not making money. So he keeps fishing.
This trip is basically pushing everything to the limit. It's pushing my crew and myself to the limit. It's pushing the boat to the limit. Just everything is like stretched out to the almost breaking point.
It's 4:30 a.m. and the crew's back to work after just a few hours sleep.
So I work before the sun comes up, every day, 4 o'clock.
Set number 20, see, it feels like set number 40.
It's late October and the conditions are brutal.
It looks like it's blowing about 25 or 30. Blowing just enough now to make our work twice as heavy.
This is the 20th haulback of the trip. And one of the most difficult. If they were on the fish, it might be worth it.
It's wet, it's raining, it's foggy, it's rolling, not a lot of swordfish. It sucks.
Catch a fish, we'll open it back, but it's better to be safe than sorry.
The conditions are dangerous, but it also tangles up the gear, costing the crew time and money.
What the example.
All them big swells we had all last night, this morning, every leader, every bullet ball was twisted up, snarled up, tied up.
Hour after hour brings up nothing but empty hooks and tangled lines.
Go on in, eater.
After 10 grueling hours, the last beeper is hauled.
All done for the day. Yahoo.
Finally, the day's over. Thanks be to God.
Check that board out. That's what the board is.
Only a few more, though.
And we're all done. This was a tough day. I think this was our toughest day.
22 miles to the southeast, the Seahawk under Captain Linda Greenlaw is back at the start of her 30-mile mainline. Deckhand Dave Hiltz has had a tough first season sword fishing.
I'm resigning right now.
Watch.
I'm done, that's it.
Oh, Archie, I just got electrocuted.
Where?
And now, after weeks of poor fishing, the rest of the crew are ready to call it quits, too.
Now we want to go home! Now!
Let's just walk off that and go in our bunks. What's she gonna do?
Beautiful weather. Sun's just coming up over that fog bank over there. What a day! Look at this day, guys. Aren't you happy to be here?
Yep. No.
It might be sunny, but the water is getting colder, and the swords have started to migrate south. Linda is gambling the big ones are still here.
Handful of those nice ones. Changes the whole complexion of the trip.
The first hooks come up empty. The pressure is on this legendary captain.
Get a gaff, mate.
20 hooks in, the first bite.
Here it is. They grab the other hook.
The first sword's worth at least $1,500.
That's what I'm talking about.
It's a nice start, but they have a long way to go to catch up.
That's a great fish. Need a few more of them.
I'm gonna say this is probably a triple marker. Beautiful. Fish we like to catch.
I never know anything.
It's a sword.
We just went onto the boat. We ain't ever going home now.
Another marker. But this one isn't making it easy for the crew.
Right there. Down deep, down deep. Nice, Archie, you pissed him off. Miss.
Gaff!
Gaff.
Gaff up here.
Okay, now it's coming. Spike him.
31.
Watch out, you pissy.
Nice fish.
When they woke up this morning, the crew could only think about going home.
Go ahead and get them.
Could just walk back.
Now there's no time to think. They're catching fish.
Nice fish, Lenny.
Yep. It's all right.
Next dob's heavy, too. Go!
On the roll. Come on, Lenny.
All right, nice.
Very happy to see bigger fish. Healthy-looking stuff.
Our luck's changing for the worse. We're starting to catch fish. It means we're not going home.
This one set has brought in over 3,000 pounds of swordfish, worth as much as $15,000.
Linda, you didn't tell us we came out here to go sword fishing.
I know, I should have warned you.
Holy crap, look at that. Look at that in the hole. That is awesome.
It was a great thing.
This is the way I remember longlining.
Yeah.
Today.
Well, we made money tonight. It would be nice. One more shot like that tomorrow. Go home. At least we're making some extra money right now.
Finally, the men are making money. If Linda can stay on the fish, she just might salvage this tough season. 300 miles off the New England coast is the little southern boat Big Eye. Captain Chompers has steamed southwest to avoid the worst of the fall storms.
We've been running for 5 days. We ain't been able to fish. Anytime you spend that many days out without fishing, it's not a good outcome.
But instead of escaping the weather, he's been running right through it. Now he has a small window before the next storm hits.
We might only have maybe 2 nights of fishing, maybe 1 night of fishing. And then we're gonna have another depression low coming up behind us again.
But this is the only day we got, so we gotta do it. Even if it ain't the best spot, we gotta make it the best spot because it's the only place we can get. Hopefully it'll pay out. We'll know tomorrow.
6 days ago, Chompers unloaded his catch and scored big with 25,000 pounds, worth nearly $100,000. But this second trip has been a complete bust.
Beautiful afternoon. Put this first beeper out on our string. Hopefully keep your fingers crossed. Have some good fish on there tomorrow. We're ready to rock and roll, baby.
God bless the guy!
It takes the crew 5 hours to set out 30 miles of mainline.
The last 5 days, we've been inside the whole time. It's like being in jail. So the next time we get a chance to do like this, you know, it's pretty fun, you know?
Matt and Woody take advantage of the calm night for some squid jigging.
There's one,
no. God, he's hooked up! See, look, you let them grab it when they come up close to it, they're gonna get it. I thought you're gonna get squirted in the face pile. That's the whole fun about it, man. Got me a squid. Damn, he's trying to get a hold of me with them tentacles, though. Look at him, he's all toughed up now, like he's pissed.
Look at that color, holy
turning
cow.
Turning black. Yeah, he's pissed. Yeah, he's pretty mad right now. He's trying to squirt us.
Every throw of the jig brings another squid onto the boat.
Yeah,
his ass is big.
How you ran off?
Tuna bait.
So that's a real good sign that we're catching squid. Possibly see some tunas tomorrow.
But tonight, it's not bait, it's dinner.
Here it goes. Looking good. Stay hungry on the boat, man. Fried calamari, it's the best.
Woody. A plus, son. It's good.
Well, my mom taught me how to cook them. God bless mom.
God bless mom.
As the crew unwinds below deck, Chompers has his eye on the weather report. One of the biggest storms of the season is set to strike in 24 hours. It'll be a race to haul his last set and get out of the danger zone in time.
We're gonna run back to our other end and we're gonna start the haul. We'll see what we get. We're gonna get a lot of wind for sure, but that's all I got. That's all I can do. I have to make this work.
Seven 700 miles to the northeast, Captain Scotty and the Eagle Eye 2 are preparing for their 21st haul back.
We haven't seen land in a long time. This trip has just been a grind. We've had a couple of, you know, so-so days there, but you know, nothing that I would call spectacular.
After just 2 hours in the sack,
you're tired, man.
The crew is back at it.
It's dangerous out here when you're half asleep. That's what happens after any time after the 20th set. You'd lose your mind.
A week ago, Scotty extended his trip.
We're gonna stretch the trip out a little bit. We're probably gonna make another 10 more sets.
And now has 50,000 pounds of fish in the hold. He plans to be the last boat in. He's gambling that the price of swordfish will jump at the end of the season when the fishing is done.
As long as the price comes up, it'll be a smart move. You know, that's the bottom line. That'll make this whole move worthwhile.
Just a 50-cent increase in price could add a few grand to each deckhand's paycheck.
We got something going on here. We got a little weight. I think he's up forward on it.
Whoa! A little
Swordfish!
It's a huge triple marker, a sword weighing well over 300 pounds. It could be worth over $1,500.
That's the kind of fish we want to see. You don't need a lot of them to make a day this time of the year.
Swordfish!
Once again, Scotty is making this look easy.
Swordfish.
But that means there's no rest in sight for the weary crew. Just one fat paycheck.
Ah! Two dandy fish there this morning, two beauties. Yeah, man. Keeps going like this now for 3 days. Gonna be a happy bunch of fellas.
Got a fish on the loop right here. Don't really know what it is yet.
Give me anything, swordfish, bluefin, something big. They're fighting, so I don't know what it is.
It's one of three things, a big mako, a bluefin or a big swordfish.
Lovely day to catch a big fish. Lovely.
Tommy Fox has a battle on his hands. He's paying the gear in and out, not giving the fish a chance to snap the line.
Go ahead, just let it go. If she takes it, she takes it.
There's something on there that don't want to come up there, right? Not yet, anyway.
Foxy, be careful of your feet in that line, would you?
Forty-five minutes later, Tommy is still working the fish. Thousands of dollars are at stake.
He's in the bubbles. Just take your time putting that leader on. Don't rush it. He's on his belly. He's whooped if we just take it easy with him.
Got a swordfish?
Yeah. Got him good?
Yeah.
Once on the surface, the real fight begins.
Fish fought like you can't believe. I still don't believe it.
It'll be an $800, $900 day.
Scotty's gamble is paying off. If this keeps going, he could be in line for his most successful trip ever.
Skipper, count him, I'll haul him in.
And the crew could score a bumper paycheck.
22 swordfish. That's how we caught them. We even got a This Rocks up here with a happy face, so you know everybody's in a good mood.
Miles off Cape Cod is the Francis Ann. Captain Chris Clem is attempting his last haul back of a stormy trip.
This wind has got everything churned up. I think right now, they're just taking some weather forecasts and putting them in a cup, shaking the cup out, rolling them out, and they're picking out whatever they want right now, I think.
Over the past few weeks, Grand Banks storms have battered the Francis Ann, destroying some of their gear.
What the? We're parted off, what else is new? And that fails.
Then a rogue wave almost took out the boat. With only 4,000 pounds in the hold, Chris is praying the last set puts some fish on the deck.
Rat sword, win. What else could be more favorable? I wouldn't mind a nice big treat, and that definitely isn't a treat I'm looking for. Rat sword.
A rat is a swordfish under 50 pounds and too small to legally keep.
Time consuming, a waste of gear, cutting off a bunch of hooks, put the frown on everybody's face when they see it.
Captain Clem has been beaten. This will be his last set of the season.
Last beeper.
And we're closer to home. Last beeper and beeper right here, and that's it. That's all she wrote.
After a disastrous season, Chris turns the Francis Ann home.
probably miss a lot of things while we're out here fishing, so it's kind of tough on everybody, you know. Kids growing up. I tell you one thing, I love coming home. There's nothing better than coming home to people that are happy to see you. That's the best thing.
...300 miles off the coast of Newfoundland, the Seahawk is getting ready for their fifth haul back.
Keep those fish, it'd be great. But if things don't improve, I'm gonna be wishing that I went home.
Even after yesterday's big catch, Dave Hiltz is still miserable.
Red sky in morn, sailors take warn. Red sky at night, sailors delight. So basically, we're screwed today.
Linda is in a tough spot. She needs to keep catching fish to pay her crew. But the crew is beat down and ready to head home. If this set doesn't pan out, she may have no choice but to call it quits.
It looks heavy. There may be something on there. I don't know. Shark!
Sharks are worse than empty hooks for the crew.
Another shark.
They have no commercial value.
Don't tell me. We have another shark.
Cut our brand new gear up. This sucks. This is a nightmare.
Even worse, they tangle up the gear.
Sortie. We don't know how big it is yet. Is that too small? Yeah, it's alive. Let him go.
Linda's gamble is looking like a complete bust. A rat.
Everything's right. There's just no fish here.
See you next year, buddy.
Even after all her careful calculations, Linda can't find the fish.
We're not doing well at all. If it goes on any longer, I'll forget how to clean a swordfish.
At the end of the season, the fishing sucks. Time to go south. Follow the fish. I want to go home.
We are about 300 yards from the beeper.
The crew gets ready to haul the last beeper of the set and the last set of the season.
Does that mean the end of Grand Banks season 08?
That's okay.
The end of Grand Banks 08. Since the end of the season. Don't let it break your heart.
Oh, nine. Can we stay? Can we set tonight?
Get steaming for home. We're headed. Running out of time. I hate to go. I always hate to go.
Linda has decided to cut her losses and start the 5-day steam home. The Seahawks' terrible fall season on the Grand Banks is over.
If we stayed, we'd probably just be throwing a lot more bait in the water and burning a lot more fuel. Even knowing all those things, it's still hard to leave.
Hit the rack.
It's over, guys.
...300 miles from New England, Captain Chompers and the Big Eye are back at the head of their gear. This renegade captain is desperate for fish.
I won't stop until my mark's made, until I do whatever I gotta do.
With a nor'easter bearing down, Chompers knows he's in for a grueling haul, but nothing will stand in his way.
Basically, it doesn't really matter what the weather's gonna do. We got all our gear out, so it don't matter if it's gonna blow 100 or 200 or we're in for it here today, so.
First set today, beautiful weather. And after today, it's gonna get bad again. You just gotta take the chances when they come. And when the weather gets rough, just gotta let two lay up. Hope that it passes quick.
I think everybody's a little excited to go fishing today. We seen a shark last night, and hopefully that ain't what we got. Usually when you see a shark on top of water, that's what you get.
God bless the Big Eye today. Hopefully we'll have lots of fish on our gear.
God bless the Big Eye.
The first beeper buoy is hooked and brought on board. And already, there's a problem.
I don't know, Weeks, what do you think? We got some nice tangle that don't want to come out.
What a
Right here, huh?
Everybody get a piece of this. Go different ways with it. No, get pieces of it.
It takes the crew over an hour to untangle their line.
It's out now and we'll be back on track.
When the sun rises, the haul goes from bad to worse.
Blue dog.
You sit up and you set and you catch one or two.
This ain't the case. We seen him and we got him. Him, his whole family, every generation of them.
The big eye is pulling up nothing but blue sharks.
The Shamu blue dog.
Blue dog.
You're really screwing up a lot of our gear.
I'm telling you, it's gonna be a long day here for us today.
The sharks tangle and destroy the gear. Each lost hook is worth $5.
The weather is getting bad. It's not easy right now.
By mid-afternoon, they've caught nearly 500 sharks and just 10 swordfish.
We're making their money today.
As the sun sets, the crew has been hauling 12 hours. And then the line parts off. A long day is about to get longer.
Well, we just potted off.
Now we're all f***ed up.
As darkness falls, waves start to tower over the big eye. Chompers has no choice but to abandon his gear.
We've lost 5 miles of gear today.
He breaks the bad news to fiance and business partner Anna by telephone.
Just had one of the worst haul backs I've ever had. Totally destroyed.
Deploy both birds.
Chompers drops the stabilizers. Now he must think about survival.
The low pressure is on top of us and the seas are on our side. The seas are intensifying, the wind is intensifying. We're intensifying low pressure. And we're getting hammered here. So there is no turning back. We just gotta ride the storm out.
Barnegat Light, New Jersey. Captain Chris Clem is bringing the Francis Anne home after a trip from hell.
Terrible. This is pretty much like 8 sets for 1,000 pounds a day. If we're lucky, I mean, if we have 7,000 down there, I'll be happy, so.
It's the way this business is. You gotta take the good with the bad. You're not gonna fill the boat up every trip. You're not gonna make a kill on every trip. You'd like to, but it just doesn't happen that way.
For Greenhorn Dave, this has been an unforgettable experience.
Good times, a lot of times, a lot of weather, you know. We didn't do too good fishing from what they're telling me. We caught fish, but I guess it's not the norm. It's not what they're used to catching, you know. So I could definitely see where it's a lot more strenuous and stuff, you know. It's a lot more to come. You know, I'm pretty excited and stoked about going out again.
As the Francis Anne heads into port, thoughts of storms and bad hauls are forgotten.
Have you been?
Anytime you make it back from the Grand Banks alive, that's a good trip.
It's good. Weather, all right. You know, fishing was slow, the weather was bad, but yeah. I'm home.
For all the hardship, Dave is excited to get back out to sea.
It's awesome. Loved the whole thing. It was the coolest thing. It's the hardest work by far I've ever done in my life.
Mm-hmm. Now they'll pack out the catch and see what their paychecks look like. As the fish comes out of the hold, the crew tries to mentally add up the numbers. Expectations are low.
I don't know if it was bad weather or bad fishing this trip, but fish just weren't biting, weren't cooperating with us. And there were nights the weather was so bad we had to put out less gear, take nights off. Sucks.
But after an hour, it's looking like they could be in for a surprise.
Fish look great, Brian. Wow, these fish are a lot bigger than I thought.
It's the biggest fish I've ever seen in my life.
Yeah, that's the biggest fish we got this trip. I don't know, hopefully it's 350 or 400 pound of bluefin.
Bluefin are the most valuable tuna on the market. Early in 2009, a single prime bluefin sold for $170,000 at Tokyo Central Fish Market.
67.
The buyer takes samples to check the tuna for fat content and color. This will determine the price per pound.
It's fatty. I mean, you can feel it. I mean, it's greasy.
Fat's good, you know, the color isn't good at all, but as long as it's got one or the other.
Now, it's all about the weight.
$417.
It's a $4,000 fish, only a fraction of the $170,000 bluefin sold in Tokyo, but a nice bonus for an otherwise bad trip.
Hopefully we, you know, stock 25 or 30,000 on fish this trip. But the expenses I don't think are gonna be all that high. You know, hopefully they're about 10 or 12,000 for expenses this trip. Yeah, hopefully the guys will make something. You know, they're not gonna make a fortune off of this trip. You know, if they make 1,500 or 1,800 bucks, I'm sure they'll be happy.
I really try not to think about how much money I make each trip. You know, you gotta take the good with the bad. And if you start thinking about how, you know, numbers and how much you made each trip, you're just gonna drive yourself crazy.
It's not a lot of money by all means to spend all that time out at sea right now, but the guys understand that. They've been on the boat long enough to know. But they made something.
When all the numbers are added up, the crew walked away from this 8-week season with close to $5,000 in their pockets, a fraction of what a top boat makes, but enough to get them through the winter. Barnegat Light, New Jersey. Having packed out their catch, Captain Chris Clem and the crew of the Frances Ann hit the local watering hole.
Way to go, Chummer. Way to make me come back healthy.
Thanks for bringing us home.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you, man. Just happy we got back safe. We didn't really break anything on the boat this trip due to the weather, but I feel defeated. Of course, I'm sure any skipper would feel defeated, you know, coming in not with a full catch of fish.
We pretty much cut off all contacts with the civilized world for 2 weeks at a time and go out to do something that's real dangerous. We can get hurt, die, who knows, but I love it.
Deckhand Dave loved it too, but did the out-of-work plumber make the grade?
First impression, we thought we were screwed. We did, not gonna lie.
We're ready to go back out, man.
Be ready, we'll leave in a couple days.
Yeah, I know, 4 days, man.
With little fanfare, Dave is invited onto the crew.
He's coming out on the boat with us again this trip. I mean, he's got potential. He loves to fish. You know, he pays attention to what you say. He watches everything you do. He's a quick learner. I don't have one thing bad to say about the kid, to be honest with you. I never even yelled at the kid. Well, man, next trip, hopefully the weather will be nicer. I know the fishing will be fine. I know how to catch them. We'll find them.
The Frances Ann.
Miles off the New England shore, Captain Chompers and the Big Eye are in the heart of a violent storm.
There's a big range rolling by. It just ain't a joking matter, I can tell you that. Nothing to underestimate, I can definitely tell you that. It'll hit your
By midnight, the winds are blowing at more than 60 miles per hour, and the waves are pushing 30 feet. Even worse, the Big Eye is starting to fall apart. The Atlantic is ripping tiles off the deck. Chompers is afraid he's taking on water.
Open the hatch and look and make sure, and then make sure it's locked.
He sends little brother Woody out to survey the damage.
Look okay down there?
Yeah.
No water, right?
Get this tile, go to work.
Put the garbage in the barrel, Woody. boat, turn around, get back on the boat and sleep.
You get hit by a wave, could slam you against anything, make you disabled, and then the next one could come and pick you up and wash you overboard. I've seen guys get washed overboard already and we never find them. By the time you turn back around, they were gone to the bottom.
It's now up to Chompers to get the big eye through the gale. The crew can only sit and wait.
Everything's cool. Just stay right here, bunk. Relax. Everything's all right.
Nothing you can do about it. Just roll with it.
If something happens to the big eye this far out, the radio won't be much help.
You gonna come up here and you hail a new hour on that radio and you're gonna do a bit of good.
As the waves pound the big eye, Chompers and his crew ride out the storm. There is nowhere to run and nowhere to hide. Forty miles north of Boston is the fishing town of Gloucester, Massachusetts, the oldest seaport in America. More than 10,000 Gloucester fishermen have been lost to the sea in the last 350 years. Each year, they remember their dead. One such tragedy occurred in October of 1991, when the swordboat Andrea Gale went down with all hands. Seven 700 miles east, and exactly 19 years later, the Seahawk is steaming home past the last known position of the Andrea Gale.
It's Halloween, October 31st, and it is the anniversary of the Halloween Gale of 1991, which is now known as the perfect storm.
A huge mass of cold air over eastern Canada slamming into a big warm air mass and moving right in between the two, a strengthening monster low pressure system that became the center of this deadly storm.
In 1991, Linda was captain of the Hannah Bowden, the sister ship of the doomed Andrea Gale.
I was out fishing during that storm and six of my fishing buddies were lost aboard the Andrea Gale.
It hit close to home. I knew the guys. They weren't just, a boat name that I recognized.
It was a lot closer than that. I knew the men.
The perfect storm exploded violently across the eastern seaboard. On land, it caused more than $200 million worth of damage. But at sea, it was deadly, claiming 12 lives, including the men of the Andrea Gale.
It formed very close to the Andrea Gale's last known position. There was a weather buoy in the vicinity that recorded 100-foot seas. It's not really that difficult to imagine what could have happened to the Andrea Gale. My opinion is that whatever happened to the Andrea Gale happened very quickly. The boat just, boom, catastrophic, went down so fast that no one had a chance to scramble to do anything.
Alfred Puri, who was one of the crew members on the Andrea Gale, worked for me in 1991 on the Midnight Sun. And he came to me and said, I have a chance to fish on a boat out of Gloucester called the Andrea Gale. Sometimes I regret letting him go, because had I said, no, you're working with me, maybe he'd still be here today. I had the idea to do a memorial for the guys on the Andrea Gale when I realized we were going to be out here on October 31st. We're in the same exact heading and course, so this is the time really to do it.
Some of us knew some of the crew members. I did personally, and I wanted to do a memorial for the guys.
When you lose guys, when they leave, you don't know that they ever get remembered again by fellow fishermen, you know?
...500 miles to the east, Captain Scotty's also thinking back to the events of 1991.
We try to keep an eye on the weather the best we can, but sometimes things just get beyond your control and tragic consequences occur.
During the perfect storm, Scotty was captain of the Seahawk, the same sword boat Linda is captain of now.
It just looked absolutely horrible. It's the worst thing I've ever seen on the charts. No feeling of terror that I can, you know, convey to you. You have to actually be out there in it to really truly experience it. And it's a total feeling of helplessness. Basically, you're watching waves twice the size of buildings come at you, and they're merciless. You know, every wave could be your last one. At one period of time, I just kept, you know, I was glad to see the next big wave because I figured it was finally over. I wouldn't have to watch him no more, so.
It's original.